I have to say that this has been something of a striking, even a weepy weekend for me. I'm comfortable enough in my manhood to say that. You know, I think about the bookends of what's happened in the last 24 hours for me. On the one hand, we have here the happy privilege of praying with the Edelmans. And I really do care for them deeply. I've known them for many years. And I know and I can hear in Lisa's own testimony the very heartfelt desire of a parent to raise their children, to know the love of Christ. And how early on when you're dedicating an infant or baptizing an infant, that you do so with all sorts of joy and anticipation. And life is unfolding before you with all its potential. So on the one hand, ministry this weekend as I was preparing for the Sunday service, well, it encompassed prayerfully preparing for a dedication and all the joy and anticipation that goes into that. And yet on the other hand, yesterday I officiated the funeral of Jimmy's son. Some of you know him. He had been involved with CAFE for many years and he died at 35. It was not too long ago that I actually officiated the funeral of his older brother. And as I was ministering to Jimmy's mom, and what do you say? How do you navigate the death of two sons? Death with its apparent ending of all potential. And so I stand here at this pulpit between two things. Between a dedication and life with all its potential unfolding before it, and a commemoration of a life that has ended. And I ask myself the question, is the gospel real? Does the gospel make a difference? Is it true? Is it really transformative? Is it something that could sustain you through the loss of two sons to terrible illness? Is it something that when you are keen with all the dreams, poignant dreams that you have for your children, that you can say, whatever they may become, I hope they become people of the gospel? Is it that real that you can bank your life on it that way? We've been exploring this gospel for the last several weeks during the season of Lent, seeing how God has laid out before us this grand narrative of his presence in this world, this inbreaking of his good presence. And how we are caught between two narratives, the narratives shaped by God in this gospel message, and the narratives that so often really shape our lives as we are being pressed by all our own ambitions and the stories and the narratives of what's really important to those around us, our culture, society. And so we have to ask the question, is it real? Is it real forgiveness? Is there real healing? Is there real hope? Because life is too short to mess around. Sorrows are too real to avoid. Aspirations are too keen to ignore. What we desire to do this evening is to connect some dots. Connect the dots between our own search for something that is real, something worth passing on to our children to bank their lives on, and something to sustain us if our children are robbed from us in a life that is all too short and fraught with difficulty. The gospel that connects the dots, that makes sense of our lives. Though broken by sin, a message that tells us we were made for God and that we can be restored by this salvation. Now, you might not be coming into the service this evening particularly raw with emotion, but I'm sure at some point, you will be. Maybe even tomorrow or next week. And you will ask yourself the question, is the gospel real? Is it worth it? Can it change my life? You may have answered the question at some level, but you will ask it again at some point. And so I want to invite us to take our concerns, whether we're in this raw moment of life, or we're in a moment of, wow, transcendence and pleasure and goodwill and happiness, because we're all going to have to ask this question. Is it real? Let's pray. God, at some point, we're going to know what it feels like to be broken by sin. We might not know to call it sin, but we will know that something is not right. And against this, we will also know that our hearts tell us that we were made for more, that we were intended for something different. And we're going to want to connect those dots. We ask that by the gift of your Spirit, you would do some of that this evening. And we would walk away with a rich appreciation, a deeper yearning, a firmer assurance that yes, in fact, the gospel is real. And we pray this in the name of Jesus, who is at the center of all of this. Amen. Last week I quoted Pascal, who made a point about human longing, and I want to pick up with that. What is it then that this desire, this longing that all humans have, and this inability to satisfy the longing, what is it that it proclaims to us? But that there was once in man a true happiness of which there now remain only the mark and empty trace, which he in vain tries to fill from all his surroundings, seeking from things absent the help he does not obtain in the things present. But these are all inadequate, because the infinite abyss can only be filled by an infinite and immutable object, that is to say, only by God himself. He is in his way groping for the words to say that we were made for God and that salvation seeks to restore us to what we were truly made for and to be. There are all sorts of ways we can look at this passage, and I know that we looked at it last week from one angle. We're looking at it again from a different angle. We're doing what I talked about a few weeks ago with the art history professor at Harvard, who would just make her students go and sit before a painting for 3 hours to look again, and then again, and then again, to plumb the depths of whatever masterpiece is before him or her. And we do that. We come to this passage again in order to plumb the depths of this masterpiece of what God has laid before us. And I want to point out 4 words here in this passage that helps us to understand what we were made for. What it means that we were made for God. Peace. Because we were made for God, we were made for peace. Verse 1, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God. Now, the ancient Greeks thought peace primarily in terms of the absence of war. Maybe because they were a warlike people, that they thought of peace in those terms. We nowadays, certainly in America, we tend to think of peace as an interior experience, some inner feeling of calm. Of course, the Bible has elements of both. But biblical peace is far more robust. Biblical peace doesn't stop with the absence of conflict, though it can include that, nor with psychological well-being, though it certainly can include that. But fundamentally, biblical peace describes the blessing of being in harmony and therefore in wholeness. In harmony with God and with other people, and because of this relational harmony, we find personal and communal wholeness, a restoration. And this peace is something that actually can occur within conflict. For me, one of the most tender pictures of moments of tragedy, it could have been the tragedy after the Twin Towers. It could be seeing a band of soldiers gathering together after a particularly gruesome battle. It's to see these people gathered together in the midst of conflict, hugging one another, embracing one another. It's not so much the absence of conflict, but in the midst of the conflict that would rage around us, it is to find a point of connection, a sense of harmony, a sense of wholeness, a sense of being there with someone else. Because we were made for God, even in life's conflicts, we were made for harmony and wholeness. Peace to me is getting a bear hug from God. Having him whisper into my ears as he embraces me in the midst of conflict, and to hear him say, "It can be well with your soul." Or it's to come to church at the end of a particularly difficult week and to touch someone during the passing of the peace, lock eyes, and to know that this person is your brother and sister in Christ, and you're going to get to be with them for all of eternity. We were made for peace. But we were also made for grace. Because we were made for God, we were made for grace. Verse 2, through Jesus we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. Amazing Grace is undoubtedly the most sung hymn in modern history. Probably the only song that comes close to it is the various happy birthday songs that all cultures have. Other than that, I think Amazing Grace has it hands down. One musicologist estimates that it is performed about 10 million times annually. And yet, even after being performed millions of times, every year after year after year, it somehow still retains its power. And it's brought into all sorts of situations. The Native Americans sang it as they were exiled on the Trail of Tears. During the Civil Rights Movement, as people faced hostility, they would lock arms and sing Amazing Grace. You might not like bagpipes, but when bagpipes are playing Amazing Grace at military memorials, you just can't help but shed a tear, right? I remember my first concert that I ever went to, a U2 concert. Yes, they were around when I was in high school. And, you know, back there they were edgy, not as well known, and I went to it, and I was just amazed. I'd never been to a concert before. It was astounding. And they sang their songs, and it was raucous. But you know, this one song that actually produced a silence. No one could clap after this song. Not because it was so bad, but because it was so sacred. They sang Amazing Grace. And in this auditorium, mainly of kids my age, just screaming and just brought utter silence. There is something about grace. It's because grace brings dignity. We've gained access into this grace in which we now stand. This physical metaphor of a condition, of how we approach it, occupying a certain place. Why not sit before the grace of God? Why stand? Could be that there's this religious imagery here of the high priest entering into the very holy of holies, standing before the presence of God. Or it could be that there's a royal metaphor of someone who is entering into the very throne room of the emperor. Every reason to tremble before Caesar Augustus. And yet, because the scepter has been put forward, goodwill and favor conferred, this person can stand before the emperor of the world. Regardless of the imagery, it is the source of the imagery. It is a picture of dignity. Dignity conferred. One of my favorite verses of scripture is from Leviticus. It's hard to believe that a favorite verse can come from Leviticus, but it's true. Leviticus 26:13. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt so that you would no longer be slaves to the Egyptians. And I broke the bars of your yoke and enabled you to walk with your heads held high. What an amazing image. Dignified by God's generosity. We were made for God because we were made for dignity. We were made for God because we were made for hope. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And Paul declares hope in glory, in the glory of God. But he also confronts very forthrightly the things that will bring hope and exaltation into question. He doesn't shirk away from the slow disrepair of our faith because of life's sufferings. Yet, while it may be the case that trials can erode our hope, they can also fortify them, test them, prove them to be true and worthy. And if so, if in through the testing the believer finds endurance, there's a discovery of an eager and an assured anticipation of glory. I think of hope here, the biblical hope, is a yearning for transcendence and glory. We were made for God because we were made for transcendence. We're made for lives that matter. Matter to one another, matter to God, matter in this world. Because we were made for God, we were made for love. In verse 5, and hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we are still sinners, Christ died for us. The love of God, it's at the center of this passage, because it's at the center of our faith. God's essential nature of love, well, it meets our essential need for love. And note here that God uses the present tense. It's not that God demonstrated his own love in the death of Jesus, though that is true. God demonstrates it continually in the death of Jesus, emphasizing the fact that the cross, while it is a past event, it remains a very present proof of God's love. This is why we have Easter and Holy Week and Lent. And as we approach Holy Week, we're called to recall the love that would endure on our behalf. Think about it. Love that endured the agony of anticipated suffering. It's one thing to suffer. It's another thing to know you're going to suffer and to have to anticipate it, to wait for it, to have your imagination run wild with it, and to know that the suffering you're going to have is the suffering that needs to encompass the sufferings of the entire world, all of humanity, for all of history. There's no toothache here. And Jesus, in the agony of anticipation, endured out of love. And it's another thing to endure suffering for people who appreciate it. Ah, man, if someone strokes my ego, yeah, sure, I can endure a bit of suffering for them. But what about enduring suffering for people who mock you and abandon you, whose burden that you are carrying on the road to Golgotha and all they have before you is a pavement of insults? What love is this? And love that would endure the piercing of hands and feet. Love that would endure the weight of sin. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Because we were made for God, we were made for intimacy. A tenacious, a ferocious intimacy. An intimacy that would go to the cross, endure it, and rise again to tell us about it. Yes, we are broken by sin, but we were made for God. You know, there are all sorts of ways we can put this issue. Last week, we looked at this issue of being broken by sin and looked at these images of being powerless and ungodly and sinners and enemies. I'm not going to go over that again. You could go back and listen to that, look at your sermon notes. But we are broken indeed. And we will come to discover this at various points in our lives. So how do we get to the other side? How do we take these longings, knowing that we were made for peace, for harmony and wholeness, knowing that we were made for hope, for a sense of transcendence, for grace to be dignified, for love, for a ferocious, tenacious intimacy? How can we connect to that? This is what salvation is about. That God would love us and seek us out. For me, sometimes I understand that the problem of evil is very perplexing, a stumbling block to many. But for me, the problem of love is even more perplexing, more paradoxical. It's what we're going to sing about when we sing, "How deep the Father's love for us. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom." Maybe this longing on your part is a longing to turn the wrongs of this world right. Maybe it's a longing to be declared innocent, free of guilt. Or maybe it's a longing to be made alive, to be taken from our situation of being dead in sin and to have God's love poured into our hearts as the very life blood of our souls, restoring us, resurrecting us. Maybe the image that resonates for us in the gospel is being set free. We know what it means to be addicted to X, Y, and Z, to be addicted to sin of any sort, And we long to be freed from that. So the image of being slaves set free, and not only being made free, but being declared as sons and daughters of the King. Or maybe we know what it means to live a life fractured. We come from broken families, broken relationships. We know all too well the animosity that could be in a household. The screams, the tantrums. And we just long for a place of security and safety. There's a reason why we can still walk by Cheers and see people taking pictures. You know, decades after the show is done and no longer playing. And I'm not just talking about middle-aged people trying to relive their glory days. I'm talking about young people who I know probably never saw an episode of Cheers. But they all know that line where everybody knows your name. Everyone knows that line. Coming to a place where everybody knows your name. And that's what we long for. A place of friendship. There are all sorts of ways of presenting the gospel, tapping into the profound needs and longings of the human heart. I think we live in a day and age of tremendous opportunity, demand even, to be creative in our presentations of this gospel message, the message of salvation. I want to show you one attempt that has been produced by someone. James Chung, several years ago, he used to be an MIT student and a staff worker with InterVarsity, came up with something he called the big story, or the four circles, as others people have called it. And it's been used by many who have sought to, well, revamp it a little bit. I'm just going to show you one version of it, not necessarily because I think it's the best way of presenting the gospel, but it is a creative way that speaks to, I think, many in our generation. A way that I hope encourages you to consider, hey, if I had to create my own YouTube video of what the essence of the Christian faith is, what would I put up for a 3-minute spot?
I want to tell you the big story. I want to describe the gospel to you. The big story is God's story and what he's doing on the planet. You'll see that the big story that we're going to walk through has four parts: creation, fall, redemption, and mission. The Christian worldview says that in the beginning, when the world was started, God designed the world for good. God created this world we live in, and he made it good. And God made us, each of us, for himself. You were made for God. But if that's true, we've got to look around and say, what went wrong? How do we explain all of the evil and suffering around us? We were designed for good, but secondly, we were damaged by evil. Each one of us, in our own way, has experienced fractured relationships with people. Each one of us has experienced this broken relationship with God. Each one of us, in our own different ways, have abused the planet. We turned everything in. We made it all about us. We're damaged by evil. But the good news is that God loves us and loves the world too much to leave us that way. And he sent Jesus into this broken world to restore us. And so Jesus restores all things for better. When Jesus died on the cross, it showed that that damage, that death, that disease and evil would not have the last word. That Jesus overcame it and offers us a life that also can overcome evil. When you join the Jesus Revolution, when you become a follower of Jesus, you become one of God's agents, an agent of change in a broken world. God transforms you and then sends you to help transform a broken world. This big story moves us from decisions to transformation. It moves us from individualism to community. The big story moves us from the afterlife to the mission life. The goal of the Christian faith is to transform you here, make you part of a community that is sent out together to heal a broken world and bring God's kingdom now.
There may be things that appeal to you about this, and of course, all of us, it would be easy to be critics of what people put out there. Deficiencies are always to be had with a 3-minute presentation. But what would you do? You see in your bulletins a reproduction of this big story. What would you put if you were given four circles to tell the story of the Christian faith? Or if you were invited to make a cartoon strip, or a drawing, or to write a poem, or to create a short story of what it is that God is doing in saving humanity? That we were made for God, broken by sin, restored by salvation. How would you put it? Think of a friend in your life, a family member. What would make sense to them? What would reach them? We are called to be witnesses in this world. You know, another thing that happened this weekend is that Tony woke me up Saturday morning. I went to sleep early on Friday night. She woke me up Saturday morning because she was so excited to tell me something. No, we're not expecting. But there was a birth. For 30 years, we have been praying for a relative to come to faith. In all sorts of situations, near-death experiences, we thought this would be the moment. It didn't happen. Birth of our children, we thought this would be the moment. It didn't happen. Moments of difficulty, moments of joy, inviting them to all sorts of things. And we always wondered, what would make sense to them? We've used every story, big story, little story, different story. We've tried circles, we've tried napkin drawings, we've tried, you name it, we've tried it. The bridge illustration, the four, you know. It may not happen right away. It may take 30 years of hope and heartache. But there is this immense joy when you see someone come to faith. That fresh discovery that Jesus died for my sins, and I can have that? Really? It's that simple? May it be the case that this Lenten season would bring a deep and rich appreciation that Jesus did die for your sins and died for the sins of this world. Let's pray. How amazing it is that you would graciously reach out to us, lost, blind, found, now seeing, dead, made alive, slaves, now heirs, enemies, now friends. How amazing this is. How deep this love that you have for us. May we come to a fresh appreciation. May we come to a renewed desire to share it. And may we come to the long, patient endurance of prayer and witness, be it 30 days or 30 years, knowing that each confession is glorious. Jesus, you died and rose again on our behalf. And we say amen.